to the South Base Camp. Both are well worth visiting, and you can link the two by crossing three high passes. Most people trek to Kanchenjunga by flying in to a place called Tapuju. Big mistake. Take extra time. Sit on a third world bus for 26 bum-numbing hours until at last the road runs out, and then start walking through the foothills. You'll never forget it. You won't regret it either. You go through landscapes like this. Wonderful landscapes at the end of the monsoon rain region when everything is sparkling. But all the vegetation, you can almost watch it growing before your very eyes. It's fabulous. And when you look at a photograph like this, just remind yourself that every single plant that you can see there has been pressed into the soil by somebody's thumb. There's no such thing as mechanized agriculture out here. So walking through the foothills, but long before you get to the big Arctic wall of the Himalaya, is every bit as enriching and rewarding as when you actually get to the big mountains. So don't be in a hurry. Just take your time and absorb all the wonders there are, every step of the way. So we're going up, first of all, to the North Base Camp at Ankhama, and on your way there, you pass directly below this fabulous peak, Jammu, or Kumbhakarna, to give it its proper name. Look at that North Face, an incredible bit of rock architecture, soaring up out of a deep valley with a big glacier pouring along just below it and off the screen. This is Pangpaima. We're looking at the northwest face of Kanchenjunga, first climbed by Doug Scott, Pete Borman and Joe Tasker back in the 70s. They made an incredible route up there. It's got to be one of the toughest climbs ever achieved in the Himalaya. Looking at a thing like that, I'm damn glad that I'm just a wimp and a mere trekker. If you cross over the three high passes and go up to the south side of the Kanch, this is the first view that you get when you turn the corner from the Yak Pass to the Ramsey. You turn the corner and there the valley ahead is completely blocked by the south face of Kanchenjunga, which of course has five high summits over 8,000 metres. The first time I ever went to this region, I got to this point, this pile of rocks with a few prayer flags standing out of it. I was with two Sherpa friends, Pemba and Dendi, and like most Sherpas, they were devout Buddhists. And to the Buddhists, of course, Kanchenjunga is a sacred mountain, because their spirits reside on the summit. So they looked up at the mountain with a great sense of reverence and awe. And then they went the other side of that pile of rocks where there is a flat stone slab. And on that stone slab they laid out some small rupee coins, some grains of rice, and petals of flowers. These, of course, were gifts to the spirits. And then they turned again to the mountain and started to chant their prayers, over and over and over, their deep bass voices echoing across the valley. Then at last they finished their prayers, they turned to me and they said, "Now you must pray." Okay, I said, "What should I pray?" They said, "You pray the same as we do, that you come back again." So I prayed. And I've been back there on four other occasions, and every year since then I've been back to the Himalaya, at least once, sometimes twice a year. So prayers can be answered, if you believe in them. Moving on westward a little bit beyond Kanchenjunga, we come to Everest, which has got to be everybody's dream.